we're fascinated by animals that behave in ways we would never expect. Millions of us watch clips of different species that normally wouldn't come together, showing what looks like friendship, affection, and even love towards each other.
Kate took one look at her. Thank you. I'll take over now.
Oh, stop it. That just melts your heart, doesn't it?
It did.
But what lies at the heart of these behaviours? Can science explain why these unusual partnerships take place? I'm Liz Bonin, and I'm going on a worldwide journey of discovery to find out why animals of different species make friends with each other. Why a cat would adopt ducklings.
I was blown away by what I was seeing. I just couldn't believe it.
If an orangutan could really keep a dog as a pet. Or if two animals of different species could even fall in love.
So handsome.
I'm on a mission to find the world's cutest and weirdest animal friends. This jaguar and Jack Russell are inseparable. When staff tried to move the jaguar to a bigger enclosure of its own as it grew up, they were having none of it. Both cried and whined incessantly until they were finally reunited. And, you know, this does beg the question, how on earth does this work? Cats and dogs don't normally get along. But here in this wildlife park in South Africa, Bullet the Jack Russell is best mates with a predatory jaguar named Jag, who could easily have him for dinner. But instead, Bullet and Jag spend as much time as they can together in this enclosure. They eat and sleep together and are always playing together. So what's going on? For a long time, we've thought that most animals of different species have evolved to stick to their own kind and to generally not get along. But in recent years, the internet has been changing all that. Videos getting hits in their millions are showing different species interacting in ways that scientists didn't think were possible. So how can we explain these relationships? And what can they teach us about how the animal kingdom really works? To find some answers, I'm going to start by meeting a variety of animal odd couples that seem to be the best of friends. And I'm beginning my weird and wonderful journey in Atlanta, Georgia, in the southeast of America, because I've heard about an incredible example of animal friendship between the most unlikely of species. They live here in this refuge with over 1,000 other injured, orphaned, and abandoned animals.
So this is Baloo, an American black bear. He's 12 years old, and he's been at this wildlife sanctuary here in Atlanta ever since he was a little cub. And all through his life, even into adulthood, he's been keeping company with a couple of animals, well, you just wouldn't expect. And there's one of them now. That's your friend. I have never seen a fully grown bear and tiger in the same enclosure before.
Shere Khan is a Bengal tiger who's also around 12 years old.
Asian black bears and tigers do share the same territory in the Far East, but when they meet, one of them ends up badly injured or killed. And so to see these two guys, they're around 12 years old, much affection for each other is pretty amazing.
The third member of this unlikely friendship is a lion called Leo.
The bear's the boss, and then Leo the lion falls in second, and then Shere Khan's a little, you know, he's a little wild child. When they're sleeping in the clubhouse, all three of them, they pile in together. They just know each other and they love each other.
Jama Hedgecoth is the founder of this sanctuary, and she's looked after the three of them since they were just a couple of months old. Kept illegally as pets, they were confiscated by the authorities and brought to her wildlife sanctuary.
They had been in a dark basement, and they were all kept together. And then the tiger and the lion's noses were busted up, and they're scarred to this day.
What absolutely fascinates me is the fact that these are grown predators in their own right,
yes,
who are displaying so much affection for each other.
Right, yes.
What do you think is going on here?
Well, they're truly a family. They've never been separated. We tried twice when they first came in, and they wouldn't eat. They cried all day. So after about 8 or 9 hours, I said, oh, well, they're just babies. Let's put them back together.
Would you describe these three as friends?
Very close friends. I wished I had a friend as close as they are.
It's difficult, yes, not to, yes, to think that they are friends, yes, that they care for each other when you see how they behave with each other.
Yeah.
Except for that.
Oh, yeah. They get to going.
Is this play going on?
Oh, yeah, this is play. Shere Khan is pushing Baloo, and Baloo is ready to go to sleep. And Shere Khan does this all the time. He does it to Leo, too.
I'm loving Shere Khan's personality.
Yeah, I mean, Shere Khan is the one that...
Look at that. Stuff.
Yeah, and he'll have to back down.
It's nice to have seen that kind of behavior, too.
Yes.
For some reason, it just makes me happy that they have those kind of...
Oh, yes.
Barneys,
well,
you know?
They have to, because they're not sedated. They're real.
No, exactly.
That is who they are.
I'm amazed by what I've seen. So to get a scientific view, I've asked Clive Wynne, a psychology professor who studies animal behavior, to have a look at this unlikely animal friendship.
What would you make of this situation, Clive?
It's beautiful. I really love it. I think it's marvelous to see animals that started out such difficult early lives being given such a beautiful home, being given true sanctuary. I think it's a wonderful thing to see.
And what do you think about the nature of their relationship? You know, how they behave together and, dare I say, how they might feel about each other?
Yeah. Well, so I've been watching them play for a little while now with each other, and I've been thinking about, well, what's the best way to capture what I see? There are elements of rivalry. There is a pecking order here, and I saw the tiger testing the bear a little bit. And you get that with brothers. So I would say it's a brotherhood.
Do you think one of the big factors involved in this relationship, especially in the early years, was a certain type of bond to relieve the stress they were experiencing?
Yeah, absolutely. There's good research. I mean, obviously not on lions, tigers, and bears, but animals at all stages of life, including ourselves, get buffering of stress. It reduces your stress to have a companion with you, a friendly companion with you. And one feels it oneself, right, in your daily life. If you have to go and do something stressful, it's much nicer if you can bring a buddy along.
So it seems that the friendship these three found in each other helped them through the tough early days. And over time, it developed into a wonderfully close, lifelong bond. The need to find a friend, no matter who they are, is clearly a very strong instinct. You can see it in animals that have been brought together by captivity, particularly if they're very young. Just like this baby chimpanzee who's found a companion in a puma cub. And there's one factor that always seems to be involved in their everyday lives: play. So why is that? Is play a crucial part of what creates these cross-species bonds? To find out, I've travelled to South Africa, just outside the coastal town of Port Elizabeth. Meet a couple of animal friends who just want to play all the time. But that doesn't really explain...
...with a sheep, and how close does this bond become, and what is it about that bond that makes these animals de-stress and give them a better chance of survival?
It's purely the companionship of not being alone. When they're alone, they're uncertain, they can't see well. They're very insecure animals, the calves. You wouldn't think of a rhino as being timid, but
no.
Especially the white rhino, they're very timid.
I find rhino bums amazing. They're just so fat and gorgeous with a little dinky tail. They're amazing, aren't they?
With the careful introduction of a close companion, precious rhino lives are being saved. But could such a deep bond ever develop between different species without our encouragement? I've travelled to the west coast of Canada, just outside the town of Courtenay on Vancouver Island, because I've heard about the most endearing relationship between two different species that came about purely of their own choice.
Many companionships between different species develop because of captivity. Circumstances essentially bringing animals together who normally wouldn't keep each other company. But here on this tiny little corner of Vancouver Island, two animals have been hanging out together for years, and they're both free to come and go as they please. Pippin is a wild black-tailed deer who's formed an incredibly close bond with Kate, the Great Dane that lives in this house. Pippin leads a wild existence, coming and going as she pleases. So I've been told the only way she might approach the house while I'm around is if I hide inside. Five years ago, Kate's owner, Isabel Springett, discovered Pippin in the woods when she was just a tiny newborn fawn. She left her there, hoping her mother would come back and find her, but it didn't quite work out that way.
The next day, I started hearing the crying, and that went on for 3 days. So that was it. I thought, this is crazy. I'm taking her in. And the only reason I put her on the dog's bed is because it was the only spot to put her.
Yeah.
And Kate took one look at her, and that was it. It was, thank you, I'll take over now.
Oh,
you know.
Stop it. That just melts your heart, doesn't it?
It did, yeah.
This is a film Isabel took of those early days together.
There is this maternal behavior going on with Kate?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, she never had puppies, but when it comes to little things, she's maternal.
But did Kate ever suckle?
No, she had nothing to suckle with, okay. But she would try.
Really?
Oh, boy, did she try.
So Pippin tried to suckle?
Yeah, Kate would stand there, and she'd be bunting and bunting and bunting. And Kate was so patient. She never told her off.
Really?
No. And we'd be getting the bottle ready, and she would be bunting and sucking on nothing, you know. Poor Kate. I used to feel sorry for her.
Poor Kate was like, it's okay, I'm just going to take it.
She'd just hump her back and stand there.
And so at what point did Pippin begin to sort of get back to the wilds, would you say?
2 weeks old. Yeah.
2 weeks old?
2 weeks old, yeah. At 2 weeks, she insisted on sleeping in the woods on her own at night. And we thought, well, if something eats her, that's just the way it's going to go. We can't interfere.
No. Would Kate ever follow her into the woods at night?
Oh, yeah. Kate would follow her. Sometimes she'd watch her go, like, oh.
She's gone.
Yeah.
Then, she never left Kate, did she? I mean, she didn't disappear forever.
No, she'd come back every day, every day.
Every single day?
Every single day.
So how long did this maternal behavior carry on?
Probably till Pip was about 6 months old. And then it sort of turned into a friendship, playtime, buddy thing. The older Pip got, the more they would play like friends. It's nothing like I've ever seen before. It's not like a dog and a dog playing. It wasn't like a deer and a deer playing. Kate toned down the aggression a little bit with the play. It wasn't, you know, she would be more aggressive playing with another dog, but with Pippin she was more careful. And Pippin seemed to be a little more rough than I've seen a deer be. So it was two different species compromising. They would smack into each other and run and leap and do their neck twirls and lick and, it was really funny to watch.
How old are these two now? How long have they known each other?
5 years, yeah. And I think Pip's had 7 fawns now.
Pippin spends the majority of her time with the wild herd, but she returns to the area surrounding the house each year to give birth to her fawns.
You know, the beginning of their relationship was a maternal, nurturing sort of relationship.
And now it's like old friends.
Yeah. What makes you think that?
The way they greet each other. They don't greet each other like, hey, you know, they greet each other like you would a really good old friend that you see quite often and you just how you doing, and just hang out. You don't even have to talk.
Do they play still, or how do they hang out?
They don't play. They're too mature for that now. Yeah. Pip's a mom. She doesn't play. But no, all they do now is they'll walk up, maybe do a little nuzzle. Kate will lick. Pip loves to lick Kate. And they just hang for a few minutes, and then they'll flop down in the shade together and just hang.
And how long will Pippin stay with Kate at any one time?
She can be here for 3 or 4 hours sometimes. She'll come into right into here and sleep on one of the dog beds with her sometimes. Yeah. Even if we were gone for 5 years and came back, they would greet each other as old friends, and it would be the same. Yeah.
This is a lifelong bond formed from a maternal instinct that developed and was cemented by years of playing and spending time together.
The relationship between Kate and Pippin is remarkable. Two animals seeking each other out to spend time together without the constraints that are often made by man. And to me, that makes this animal friendship far more compelling than in captive situations.
So far, I've met many different animal friends that have found each other through their unusual circumstances, be they in captivity or in the wild. And it's clear how important play and close interactions can be for maintaining those bonds, and even for keeping an animal alive. But hearing how Kate looked after Pippin when she was a tiny fawn introduces another important reason for animals of different species to come together: the mothering instinct. On the next step of my journey, I'm going to investigate stories of misplaced mothering that defy belief. Incidents of predators ignoring their hunting instincts and instead caring for young animals that should be their prey. But first, I'm going to the south of the USA, to Mountain Home, Arkansas, and a wildlife refuge that's home to a remarkable supermum. This refuge takes on many abandoned animals in need, and it's run by a devoted carer named Janice. But it's her capybara, Cheesecake, who's the star of the show. She may be the world's largest species of rodent, but she's also an excellent foster mum to a litter of puppies. So how did this scenario arise, Janice? I mean, this capybara is surrounded by, I don't know how many puppies, I've lost count.
Yes, it's just one day I had a litter of orphan puppies that were ready to move out of the house, and this was the most secure pen for a little puppy. And I knew she was social with other animals, and she took right to it, and she's had every litter since. And
So how many litters has she had?
Well, this year alone, she's on number 4, and there's another one coming up soon, so.
So you get, unfortunately, a lot of puppies given to you from abandoned litters?
I rescue a lot of pregnant mamas, or mamas that just have given birth that are in dire straits and nowhere to go, and it's one of the specialties I do with special needs animals.
So it's an unfortunate situation, but when you say that the capybara mothers these pups, what do you mean?
She sleeps with them, she eats with them, they'll play with her, they'll groom her, and she seems to enjoy it. I think she just has kind of that aura around her that makes them feel safe and secure.
Cheesecake has never had her own young, but being a capybara is exactly what to do with this lot. In the wild, capybara help to look after each other's young, sharing the parenting duties. And what she's demonstrating is just how powerful that mothering instinct is.
So perhaps Cheesecake here, in this captive situation, has become such an excellent foster mother because her natural instincts to take care of little ones have kicked in. And I'm taking that one home. You know that, don't you?
Yeah, you can have that
good
one.
Good stuff.
The mothering instinct may come easily to a plant-eating supermum like the capybara, but can it explain why a predator would choose to mother what would normally be its prey? In Ireland, just outside the town of Clara, County Offaly, lives a young couple with the most remarkable story to tell. Ronan and Emma Lally own a small farm that they run alongside their day jobs. They have a lovely collection of animals, but wanted some ducks to complete the picture. So they got in some fertilized eggs. On the day they hatched, Ronan went to check on them, but couldn't find the ducklings in the barn.
Within seconds of that, a cat jumped down from a pigeonhole within the shed over there, and I kind of put one and one together, and I just presumed that the cat had swallowed up the ducklings.
At this stage, they were missing for about 6 hours, so Ronan thought there was no hope at all.
After searching around the farm, they eventually found the ducklings, but unfortunately, the cat, Della, had got there first.
I ended up catching the cat with a duck in her mouth at this stage, and it really looked, Ronan was like, she's going to kill the duck.
I was thinking, oh no, yeah. We're only after getting them back and now she's going to eat them right in front of us.
Then Emma noticed something unusual.
I was like, Ronan, she's not actually forcefully holding this duck.
That's when the amazing thing happened. We put the cat down, put the ducklings down, and then all of a sudden the three little ducklings waddled straight underneath the cat. The cat lay down on her side, put her paw over one of the ducklings and was kind of nursing the duckling in towards us. So we were, I mean, just absolutely blown away with this. Because normally cats would eat little small birds, but it was awesome. It was just incredible to see it.
She was very content at this stage. She was purring and she was really loving towards the ducklings. When I was petting her down, I noticed that she actually had given birth to three kittens only within an hour or so beforehand.
It was a very lucky coincidence for the ducklings that the cat found them just after giving birth herself. For a narrow window of a couple of hours, mothering hormones will have been coursing through her body, causing her to love and nurture any small, warm, furry creature she found next to her.
I have no doubt whatsoever that the cat was thinking dinner if she had seen them either maybe a couple of hours before or a couple of hours after. I have no doubt that she would have put the napkin around her neck, knife and fork, salt and pepper, the whole lot.
But it was when they came to move the unusual family into a safer spot that they got an even greater surprise.
As soon as we lifted up the cat, that's when we were totally amazed, because the ducklings were actually latched on to the cat's nipple. So
they were hanging from her. Yeah, it was very, very bizarre.
We seen them breastfeed and we just thought, oh my God, yeah, there's something very, very strange happening here, and something very strange, but also something very unique, you know.
Duck mums don't produce milk and ducklings are born ready to find their own food and water from their surroundings. So to see them suckling a cat is extraordinary. Experts can only guess that their natural foraging instinct calls them to come upon the milk as an unexpected food source. And their desire for warmth and comfort kept them close to their foster mother. Ronan was keen to separate the ducks, fearful the cat's predatory instincts might kick back in. But Emma, being a midwife, recognized something that she regularly sees at work.
There was just so much love there, you know, and like I see it every day in the labor ward. They just want to hold them babies so tight and close. It's a moment that just lasts forever. And I could see that happening with the cat and the ducks. It just took me a while to convince Ronan. Because it's Ronan, they're just so in love. They love each other. Like, you can't break this bond. It's amazing.
Before long, the ducklings started to outgrow the kittens and gain their independence, something the cat wasn't so happy with.
These ducks, her yellow kittens, were a lot more active and she found it hard to control them. She was trying to bring them back underneath her and say, now be good like your brothers and sisters.
Several weeks later, the kittens are still small and the ducks, although independent, still have an attachment to their surrogate mum. So it would seem that this rare coincidence of a cat giving birth just as the ducklings were making their first steps into the world resulted in this remarkable situation. Filled with an instinct to mother small furry creatures, the cat ignored any natural urge to eat the ducklings and took them on as her own.
Now, it could be argued that all of this only happened because it was a domestic situation with animals that were unusually close to each other. But there are other examples that suggest the mothering instinct is so strong, this can even happen in the wild. A few years ago, the most surprising example of misplaced mothering took place in Kenya.
The story of this lioness and oryx has an unhappy ending, but not for the reason you might think. A newborn oryx, surely just minutes from being this lion's next meal. But to the complete amazement of the rangers who were monitoring the situation, the lioness didn't try to eat it. Instead, she cared for it as if it were her own young. Just like the cat with her ducklings, a strong instinct to protect and nurture was overriding the predatory instinct to kill it.
Many theories were put forward as to why she was behaving in this way. And the consensus was that she was a young lioness who'd gone through some kind of traumatic experience involving being separated from her pride. And as a result, her mental state had led her to want to nurture this calf in some way.
But unfortunately, the relationship came to a sudden end. When the lioness took her eye off the calf for just a few moments, a male lion pounced and killed it. Witnesses described her behavior as exactly that of a lioness who had lost her cubs. Heartbreaking to watch.
Everyone thought that was the end of the story. But the lioness went on to adopt not one, but five more oryx calves. Now, none of the relationships lasted as long as the first one, but this continuing fixation points to a traumatized animal desperate to nurture, even if the young in question isn't her own species. The lioness was always going to struggle to keep the calves alive, especially as she wasn't able to feed them. But there is an example of cross-species mothering I've read about that caused a real stir in the scientific community, because not only was it in the wild, but it was long-lasting.
I've travelled to Sao Paulo in Brazil to find out what happened.
Hey, over here.
Hello there.
These little fellas are called marmosets. They're one of the world's smallest monkeys. I mean, this is it. They get this big when they're fully grown. Is it even conceivable to think that one of these could be adopted by a completely different species out in the wild? They are so absurdly cute. I mean, what animal wouldn't want to adopt them?
And one group of scientists discovered exactly that. It occurred in a forest reserve in the heart of Brazil, between a baby marmoset and a group of capuchin monkeys. I meet up with Professor Patricia Izar, one of the scientists at this rare event, the only long-term cross-species mothering that's ever been documented in the wild.
When the marmosets, they encounter the capuchins, usually they go away. They are afraid of the capuchins.
Yeah.
They hunt for small mammals, small rodents and marsupials and even small primates.
Yeah. So they've been known to eat a little marmoset or two.
Yeah.
Okay, which makes this entire episode, which you were privy to, even more unusual.
Yes. Suddenly one day the female appeared with a very, very tiny marmoset, probably days old. She was carrying the marmoset as if she was carrying her own baby.
This in itself was extremely unusual, but what happened next almost certainly saved the marmoset's life. The capuchin allowed the baby marmoset to breastfeed.
She was here with her mouth in the capuchin's nipple.
Yeah.
We couldn't tell for sure that she was suckling, but she was in that position several times a day as a baby capuchin, as she would do with a marmoset mother, and she survived.
What did you think when you first saw that?
That, for us, was really, really amazing.
That's unheard of. It's completely unique, this case, isn't
completely
it?
Unique, yes, yes.
Over the coming months, the marmoset became very much part of the group. But there were some differences in the way she was treated.
How does it manage to integrate into a group that's essentially very different in its behavior, in its ecology,
yes,
everything?
Perfectly.
Did it work out?
Yeah. Yes. In fact, the dominant male, sometimes we saw that he was treating her more or less like we treat our pets.
So is this possible? Can animals other than humans keep pets? Patricia has some footage that sheds more light on the relationship.
She just looks like one of the pebbles they used to crack the nuts. She's that small.
Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised they didn't squash her by accident. I mean, she's so tiny. Cracking a nut. Is she going to go in for some?
Yes.
And is he going to allow her?
Yes. See the proximity.
He's fine with her. Why do you think he's so relaxed?
Because I think she's so tiny, 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 he doesn't see her as a competition.
He's watched her take some of the nuts.
And that's okay.
It's adorable to watch it in action, isn't it?
Yeah.
And he let her, you know. Uh-huh. He's not stupid. He wouldn't let her do it if he didn't want her to. So is she like his little toy? She's so cute, she just can't
his
he can't
pet.
Help but just let her get away with murder.
Yeah.
Compared to the other Capuchins, you know.
A wild animal keeping another species as a pet is unheard of and would be a hugely significant discovery.
A great tool use as well. By the by, these are very clever monkeys, there's no question.
Tool use was once considered a uniquely human activity. So could pet keeping be another behavior that we share with other animals? We'll never know in this case, as sadly the marmoset disappeared after 14 months. Maybe a predator got her, or perhaps she joined another group of marmosets. But it does make me wonder if there are any other examples of animals that might keep pets, and if this could be another reason for different species to hang out with each other. I've tracked down another unusual friendship from a clip I've seen on the internet. It might just be an example of pet keeping in animals, and one that I can visit for myself. The animals in question live on the east coast of the US, near the tourist resort of Myrtle Beach in South Carolina. To track them down, I've headed away from the crowds to a quiet suburb on the banks of an inland river system. Here, an animal trainer named Doc Antle runs a wildlife safari park with an exotic collection of animals that includes a hound named Roscoe and an orangutan named Hanuman that appears to be treating the dog like a pet. Doc is currently training Hanuman to take Roscoe for a walk, but Hanuman seems to be taking it a step further.
He just kind of holds on to you for security.
I'm good with that.
You're the tree at the moment.
I can be a tree.
How long has Hanuman and Roscoe?
They've known each other.
Friends?
They've known each other for the last 7 years now.
And how did it all begin? Because it is a bit of an odd couple, isn't it?
They are an odd couple. They met each other by time that they spend down on the river.
Doc often takes his elephant and some of the orangutans down to the river to cool off and have some fun in the water. But on one occasion, back in 2006, they came across a stray hound dog on their route. One of the orangs, Surya, jumped down and started playing with the hound, and they instantly hit it off. Before long, all the orangs were playing and the dog had a new group of friends.
They then grab each other and play and pet and start being kids goofing around on the water. And it just engaged them, and they thought that he was a fabulous guy.
At the end of the day, Doc headed back, hoping the stray dog would find its own way home. But the hound, who they later named Roscoe, had other ideas.
The dog had made his way into the secure gated area, and he was there with them. And they have a constant supply of food there and water. They put out the water for him, and they also started taking monkey biscuits.
Oh, no, he likes my bracelet.
He's just going to look at it. They started taking monkey biscuits and handing him monkey biscuits.
Uh-huh.
And the next
so they were like, we want to hang out with Roscoe.
And Roscoe was in that state of really hunger, and he ate everything they would give him until he was looked like he'd swallowed a basketball.
Dogs have evolved to be excellent pets. And for the orangs to be feeding and caring for Roscoe suggests they may have been treating him like one. But can that really be the case? If so, that is extraordinary.
Now, we still think to this day, I think, that humans are the only animals
that keep pets. But, you know, these orangutans are very closely related to us. They're great apes as well. Do you think it's even possible they think of Rob?
I think that it is like a boy and his dog. Says, I've got my pet dog. We'll go out. We'll play fetch. We have an incredible time together. I love my dog. Now I'm drifting off. I'm with my parents. It's time for dinner. I'm going to go play baseball. And the dog becomes very secondary. I think it's more like that. They love him at the moment. I don't think they pine away for him or wonder where he is or miss him like you might see adult humans doing to a dog where they become really emotionally attached.
Pet keeping can be defined as looking after an animal of another species with a level of care and affection, primarily for reasons of pleasure. And a very significant part of that care is, of course, feeding them.
Whose is this? What's that? Do you want that?
Yes.
You want it. You want another one?
Do you want to give it to Roscoe?
No. Does he want it?
Oh, look. Gosh, look at that.
He wants it. You know he wants it. Yeah, you knew. So he just had, he wanted to do it that way, though.
Today, Hanuman hangs out with Roscoe whenever he can, and they seem to have a real level of affection for each other. They even go swimming together. Hanuman is only one of two apes in the whole world that can swim like this. Now, both Hanuman and Roscoe are obviously trained, so I wonder how much that affects what I'm seeing. To get a scientific perspective on their relationship, I brought along Professor Hal Herzog, an animal behaviorist who's been investigating pet keeping in humans and other animals for many years.
Amazing.
See, eyes wide open, couple of bubbles out of the mouth, happily swimming in the pool. I've never seen that of you.
Never.
Orangutan never. In the swimming pool.
Hal, what do you make of this relationship? You've watched the orangutan and the dog. What do you make?
Well, there's a couple of relationships going on. The relationship with the orangutan and the dog is absolutely stunning. And it's very clear that they would a deep relationship. The thing that impressed me the most was food sharing. Uh-huh. With the orangutan being perfectly happy taking orangutan chow, you know, not dog food.
It was monkey chow.
It was monkey chow for sure. And giving it to Roscoe. It was quite stunning.
So what do you think that means, that a great ape would share food with a completely different species? What do you think is going on in its head?
I think to some extent it means that the great ape is recognizing the existence of the dog as a, in a way, a like-minded creature. It's treating it like a like-minded creature, just the way we would a dog or a cat in our lives.
Do you think we can call this pet keeping?
I would.
Roscoe thinks so. You say yes.
I said Roscoe said yes.
I'm far too cynical in my old age. What do you think?
I think the relationship that those guys have would fall into my definition of pet keeping.
Really?
Yes.
You just say that is a big deal.
It is a big deal. But the thing that's interesting for me is that these relationships don't seem to exist outside human agency. And maybe the biggest part of the human agency is having a full stomach.
Hal believes that in the wild, animals are too busy finding food and avoiding predators to have the time to devote to another animal in the way we might look after a pet.
I argue that humans are the only animals that keep pets.
Yes.
Although you do see the rudiments of the motivation in other animals. And to me, what the orangutan here is doing is exemplifying that the rudiments of the urge to keep pets are right here in South Carolina. This is the perfect storm here. You've got a human being, Doc, who understands animals at a very, very deep level. You've got this ideal situation where there's plenty of food. And what this shows is that great apes, and probably a lot of other animals, are capable of deeply loving members of another species, but yet they don't seem to do it in the real world, as far as I know, with one exception. It was a case in Brazil where a group of primatologists discovered a troop of Capuchin monkeys, and they adopted a two-month-old marmoset.
I know the case.
Baby marmoset.
Covered it. Yeah.
It's absolutely fascinating. And so what to me, this does have the elements that you see in human pet keeping, is that the relationship is one of fondness. They're not getting anything out of it. They were feeding the creature. They liked it that much. And protecting it. But the other thing is it was long-lasting. To me, it's the closest thing to what I would call human pet keeping. But the thing is, it's one case of the millions of hours that primatologists have been, you know, spent with their glasses, you know, and, you know, looking at trees. It's the only case.
The fact that the potential for pet keeping exists in animals other than ourselves is revolutionary. But it's also forcing scientists like Hal to rethink what they know about animal minds. And that's what's been so fascinating about the journey I've been on.
by looking at some of the most extreme, unusual, and surprising animal friendships, we can gain a better understanding of the powerful instincts and needs that motivate all animals. Drives that are so strong, they can sometimes cross the species divide. But there is one last pairing that truly challenges what science knows about animal relationships, and that's because it involves a question of animal attraction and possibly even love. And to witness this odd couple, I'm visiting a safari park in South Africa, not far from Pretoria, to meet a kudu, a species of antelope, named Charles.
He's a fine specimen.
Charles is a male kudu, and he belongs to a wild herd here in this reserve in South Africa. Now, in a kudu herd, only the dominant male breeds at any one time, and the rest of the males disperse into bachelor herds, or they become solitary kudus, until they get the chance to usurp the alpha male and grab the throne. And Charles is one of these solitary males, for now at least.
He's by the fence.
However, this hasn't curbed Charles's desire to find a mate. And in a neighboring reserve lives a female he's taken a fancy to.
When Charles was almost a year old, he began keeping company with a female he probably shouldn't be seeking out in the first place. And the only way he could reach her was by jumping this fence.
Ah, there he is.
Now, the fact that these animals can jump a fence this high without taking a running jump is pretty impressive. It also does show quite a bit of commitment for his lady love. And he's definitely on a mission. Ever since he's followed her around, he's been hanging out with her, and the rangers have called this female Camilla. Now, just last week, for the first time ever, Charles tried to mate with Camilla, and it wasn't successful, to say the least, because Camilla happens to be a giraffe.
I've heard that Charles has jumped the fence into the reserve, so if I'm lucky, I'll get to see them together.
There he is, there's Charles. And he is coming down the hill to Camilla. God, he's so handsome. I can see why Camilla might be attracted to him.
When they meet, they do seem to prefer spending time with each other rather than the other animals in the area. And it certainly looks like Charles and Camilla are more than just good friends.
Charles and Camilla started hanging out when they were juveniles, so that does point to a relationship based on attachment hormones, companionship. But then it did turn into something a lot more primal. Now, in the wild, some animals have been known to be attracted to females from another species that resemble a fatter, healthier, more fecund version of their own species. But when you look at this kudu and this giraffe, it's kind of pushing that theory to the extremes, isn't it? So, is this a rare anomaly? Or is it just that we haven't been able to understand this kind of behavior yet? Either way, I love this story because it just goes to show how much we still need to learn about the animal kingdom. Guys, she's actually following him. Aww, very nice.
nice end to the story.
We've seen how different species are capable of remarkable, complex, and meaningful relationships with each other.
Oh my gosh.
But on the next stage of my journey, I'm going to meet some people who have extraordinary friendships with the most unlikely animals. I'll be on the hunt for the most unusual partnerships to try and find out why these animals have taken these people into their hearts and not their mouths. By studying these relationships, not only can we understand more about these weird and wonderful pairings, but we can also get an insight into the fascinating world of animal lives and minds. Feeding a hippo. Why a polar bear would let a man give it a hug.
It's just a really special bond.
And how a human could ever join a pack of hyenas without being harmed.
There's probably a reason why a lot of people don't work with these guys.
I'm going to meet some of the most profound and extreme pairings to find out what lies at the heart of these surprising human-animal relationships. Millions of us have close bonds with animals, and for most people, that means our pets, like cats or dogs like Ernie here. Not right. But some people have made friends with animals that you'd normally avoid. So how have they done this? I'm going to try and find out how these relationships have formed, why they work, and what's in it for both the humans and the animals. Go on, go on. I forgot he was tied. I'm starting by tracking down three remarkable relationships that seem to defy logic, to try and discover how these bonds form. And I'm beginning my extraordinary journey in Canada, just outside Vancouver, near the small town of Abbotsford. I've come here to meet Mark Dumas. More than 16 million people have watched a clip of him swimming with a rather unexpected female companion. Her name is Aggie. She's 18 years of age, and she weighs around 60 stone or so. Aggie is a polar bear, and Mark has been her guardian, provider, and playmate since she was 8 weeks old. Mark is the only person in the world who has this kind of bond with a fully grown polar bear. And apparently, with anyone other than Mark or his wife Dawn, Aggie can get a bit cranky.
What do I need to know, Dawn?
She's jealous of other women. So...
Seriously?
Seriously. When someone starts talking to me, takes my attention away from her, she gets upset about it. Dawn can take my attention as much as she wants because Aggie doesn't mind Dawn.
She's used to me talking all the time.
So she's super protective of you, do you think? Is that what this behavior is about or what?
I think she's just possessive.
Possessive. I need to see this with my own eyes.
Getting close to a jealous and potentially dangerous polar bear is a little disconcerting. But Dawn tells me I'll be fine as long as I let Aggie have all of Mark's attention.
I give him a little bit of time to get through the gate.
She's already very curious, isn't she?
Hi, honey. And then we stay about 3 feet away from...
So the gate's open.
The gate's open, so we can travel.
All right, so we're actually not behind a closed fence.
Yeah, come on in.
Are you sure?
I'm positive. Come on in.
For a day job.
She's right behind you, Dawn.
Hi, honey. Hi. That's her fence. She knows that's her fence. Hi, sweetheart.
Just taking stock of what exactly is going on because I didn't realize we weren't going to be behind a closed fence. And I'm staring at a polar bear who is smelling the air, figuring out who we are. And you are
utterly confident that you can predict her behavior?
Absolutely. We've known her since she was a baby, and we also know they do not view electricity the way we do. They don't logically think, oh, I can step over it or get under it. They view it as a wall. Can you hear it?
What's that?
Her Nunu. She's, if you're quiet, you can hear it.
Oh.
Do you hear that low rumble?
Yes. What is that?
That's her. It's almost like a purring noise for a cat, but it's her that she makes because she's super content and she's sucking on her tongue right now.
I thought it was an engine somewhere or something. That is actually coming from the polar bear.
That's coming from her.
She's clearly really close to Mark. How do you think Aggie sees him?
Aggie sees him as her mother and father together, really, and companion.
So this is all about Aggie thinking of him as kin.
Right.
Since 8 weeks of
age. Which would be as long as she can remember.
Listen to that.
Is that your daddy? Are you happy? Oh, happy girl.
Mark trains animals for the movie industry. And 18 years ago, he was asked to find a polar bear for a film. He'd heard about a cub that was being hand-reared by staff at a zoo as her mother was getting too old.
Aggie was the 11th baby born with this mother, so this mother couldn't properly care for her.
So Mark took her on and trained her for the film, but he didn't expect their relationship to develop in the way it did.
It's my job, and it's what I had to do, and then as I'm doing it, I became very, very attached to her.
So tell me what you feel about your relationship with Aggie.
It's just a really special bond. I love her a lot. I can't say she loves me. She really is bonded to me.
She loves him.
There you go. So we have a really wonderful relationship, and I would never change that for anything. We knew when we got her that it's a commitment we make for the rest of her life.
Mark became a parental figure for Aggie from a very early age.
When she's 2 months old, she barely's walking. And I became the middle of the night, wake up, because she's yelling, to go down and fed her and spend time with her. And then she'd go back to sleep, and then I'd go back to sleep. And then I'd wake up again early in the morning and do the same thing over again. So I spent a lot of time with her.
And do you think that was the key to having her bond with you?
Oh, absolutely. The more time you spend with them, the closer their bond is.
What would you say, because I've got to ask you, does she not belong in the wild?
She couldn't be in the wild if she wanted to. She was born in captivity. You can't take, it's very difficult to take an animal in captivity and then turn it loose in the wild. It doesn't seem to work very well.
Whatever you think of this situation, Mark has an incredibly close bond with Aggie. And even though she is a fully grown polar bear with the strength to kill with one blow, he's never felt in danger around her. And it seems this has all been made possible because he hand-reared her from a very young age. To find out how this works, I'm meeting Jason Goldman from the University of Southern California.
Certainly for a mammal like a bear, you know, we're not necessarily born with an expectation of what mom is supposed to look like or what sort of other members of our species are supposed to look like. Or even if we are, it's probably very, very easily sort of overridden. So if this young polar bear, for example, only had experience with other humans, particularly with this one human, then it stands to reason that they would develop this kind of relationship, that it would look to this human as a parental figure. But if you took a mature polar bear who perhaps had never had any experience with humans, then you'd probably get a different kind of a pattern.
Probably, I'd say definitely. So hand-rearing and training a dangerous animal from a young age can result in a close bond, and it's likely Aggie's temperament plays a part. But occasionally, this kind of connection can happen entirely by accident. To meet my next odd couple, I've traveled to South Africa and a small farm near Hoedspruit on the edge of the Kruger National Park. Here at her home on the banks of the Blyde River, Shirley Joubert is making tea for Jessica, who she looks after like a daughter. Shirley, what kind of tea are you making her?
I'm making her rooibos tea with lukewarm water and some brown sugar.
So why rooibos tea with sugar?
Rooibos tea is very healthy for her. So she has 20 litres of this a day.
20 litres of the stuff every day. You're kept busy, aren't you?
Yes, yes. But it's like doing it for a baby, you know.
Uh-huh.
And in my eyes, Jessica has never grown up.
Because she's 13, is that right?
She's 13, but she's still the baby girl.
Something tells me you love it, though.
Oh, it's my life. The bond there is just so strong, and I haven't got kids of my own. So the bond between us is so strong.
Can I keep you company while you feed her the rooibos tea?
Yes. And let's go brilliant. For it. And you see, there's Jessica.
Yeah. She's an absolute beauty, isn't she?
Oh,
she's
gorgeous.
She's rather good looking. Look at her.
Look at her. So this is Jess.
This is Jess.
Yes, Jessica is a hippopotamus. Shirley and her husband Tony took her in when she was separated from her mother as a newborn.
Oh, you're so thirsty, Jess.
She's 13. She's just drinking from a bottle.
Right, most of the...
Look at those teeth. She definitely likes rooibos tea, huh?
Oh, she loves it.
That's it. Yes. Do you want me to do it?
Yes, please.
Oh, good Lord. Okay, here you go.
That's...
Now, do I squeeze it or should she just
go
for it?
No, she just sucks on it.
Wow, weezers.
The relationship that Tony and Shirley have with Jessica is unique. This is the only place in the world I could ever get this close to a hippo.
The hairs on her snout are ridiculous. Look at that.
Can you feel you're actually relaxing?
I've never experienced anything like this. I'm just a little bit cautious, I guess.
Hippos can be extremely dangerous, and they kill more people than any other mammal in Africa.
She sucks on it afterwards.
Yeah. So tell me about how you came to have Jessica in the first place. How did it happen?
Well, we found her in the year 2000 with the floods, and she was washed away from her mother.
Right.
And, well, she washed out just in front of her house. So I ran down and I touched her.
How small was she?
She was premature, and she still had on her umbilical cord.
So she literally had been born, the floods happened, and she got washed up. What happened then?
We took her into the house, and Tony, with his game ranging experience, he actually knew the formula to make it like a mother's milk. And that was the first thing that we actually gave to her.
So you didn't have a chance to reunite her with her mother, obviously.
No, she never reunited with her mom.
What probably makes this relationship work is a process called imprinting, where an animal forms a very strong bond with the first living thing it sees. As Jessica was washed away from her mother as soon as she was born, it's likely that Tony and Shirley were the first thing she saw.
So do you think she's imprinted on you or on Tony?
I think, well, it's 50-50,
right.
Definitely. She sees us as her parents.
Yeah, your bond is stronger than I expected it to be.
You know, I don't see Jessica as a hippo. I've actually got a psychological problem with her.
Oh, you're so in love with her, is it?
I can't see her as that. I mean, when I want to hug her, I just hug her. Mm-hmm. Wherever I go, she'll be following me. And wherever she goes, I'll be following her.
Jessica also regularly wanders off back into the wild.
She's not in captivity at all. If Jessica wanted to leave, she could be in Mozambique now. But she always comes home and she always comes back.
Sometimes she sleeps on the porch with the dog. And Tony and Shirley will even give her a massage. But at dinner time, she pops into the kitchen to eat with the family.
Oh, lekker te lekker, my liefie.
Oh, good grief. This is unbelievable.
Wow. On the menu tonight, it's green beans.
So you've got the knack, huh? Baki?
Baki?
Ah! I'm feeding a hippo.
There you are.
This is hilarious. Baki. Hi, hon. Oh my gosh, she's so pretty.
Lekker te buena, mate. She wants to go out now.
When she's finished eating, she goes on her way.
Thank you, my liefie.
Tony, an ex-game ranger, has enough experience to know not to try and stop her.
You read the signs, didn't you, Tony? You were like, right, she wants to go out, there's no keeping her in.
Yes.
Because at the end of the day, you do see her as a wild animal still?
I see Jessica as a wild animal. I don't keep her in, I do whatever she wants to do.
Can we be out with her here?
Not at the moment. Let her just sort of thing out there.
Although Jessica is happy to let me feed her from behind the counter, she is still capable of charging if I get too close.
She lives a normal hippo life, but she shares her life with us as well. She goes to them, they come to her. She lives a normal life.
So she still goes out with the wild hippos that are further down the river?
That's correct, and upstream as well.
So do you think this beauty is going to be able to mate with wild male hippos and have a calf of her own? Do you think that's possible?
I don't think it's possible. Jessica will mate.
You know it's possible.
It will happen. Within 2 years, Jessica will have a calf of her own. And I will contact you.
You better.
I'm inviting you to come down again.
You better, Tony.
And you'll see her with
I need
calf,
to yeah. see this young lady
I'm confident
with
that
a calf.
Thank you, man.
I think she agrees.
What's it, Jess?
It seems that Jessica imprinted on Tony and Shirley when she appeared on their riverbank just after she was born. And that's why she's still so attached to them, even as a 13-year-old adult hippo. Our next story is of a human bond that seems to be something completely different, as they were both fully grown when they met in Los Angeles, California. I've come here to meet Dominic Erler. 3 years ago, he was befriended by a goose named Maria.
Hello.
Did you get a good night's sleep? Okay.
Maria always seems pleased to see him.
How are you? You gonna take a walk?
They're going to have a little moment by themselves.
Want to meet my friends?
Hi.
But is a little less enamored of strangers.
We're just going to check you out.
That's fine.
You're
you can check me out
well.
All you like.
The secret is just stand there.
That's
cool.
She also
gets a sense of you.
What a cutie. The crew need checking out too, you know.
Come.
Hi.
Come. Come on.
Definitely listens to you, doesn't she?
Maria didn't always live here in the zoo. Up until 2 years ago, her home was a park in central LA where Dominic used to go for his regular morning walk.
So how did you first meet?
I'm walking around Echo Park Lake. I'm just about finished and coming in, delete. One of the park employees by the officer taps me on the shoulder. He says, hey, Dominic, you know you're being stalked when you're walking around the lake. And I said, you know, what are you talking about? Because this is a big city park. There's gangs and stuff hanging around there. So he points to this goose about 50 feet away, and he just says, her name's Maria. He laughed. He thought it was funny. But I looked at Maria, and Maria was just glaring at me, just glaring at me. And I just waved and said, hi, Maria. How you doing, Maria? And I thought it was kind of cute. I left, came back the next morning, and Maria came right to me, right in front of me, and just looked up so innocently. And I just fell in love, just like that. You're my friend. And within a matter of just a few days from her just circling around me as I go, took the lead position, so Maria would always walk in front, leading the way.
The pair quickly became inseparable.
When you fall in love with a goose, you got to be aware of what you're getting involved with. But their loyalty is phenomenal. Remember, they bond for life. So I basically feel like I have a certain sense of responsibility.
For the local residents, they became something of a celebrity couple.
One time we had 100 people marching behind us as we're walking around the lake, and we're singing Maria songs, and I mean, it became such a festive thing, it was really remarkable. Maria was like the Michael Jackson of the goose world.
In 2011, the park authorities decided to drain Echo Park Lake, part of a 2-year renovation program. For her safety and survival, Maria was moved to the zoo, where staff soon discovered that she may have been misnamed.
We did a little Valentine's thing on one of the local TV channels or something, and it was a perfect relationship, unusual relationship, a man and a goose, Dominic and Maria. And I think like a week or two after that, the head vet here calls me up, humorously says, hey, Dominic, you got a problem. And I said, what's that? He says, well, your girlfriend's a boy.
So Maria became Mario.
Oh, Mario.
Is he showing
He's
off?
He's showing off.
But the bond is as strong as ever.
You visit him every day, is that right?
Every day. So it's part of my daily schedule. I love coming up here and hearing him. You know, it's nice to have an animal wag its tail and go caw, caw, caw. You know, it's great. That's the great thing about animals. They want to be our friends. Right, Mario? Baka, baka.
But why did Mario want to be Dominic's friend? Geese are well known for being a species that imprints. In fact, they were the first animals scientists studied when they were trying to understand the phenomenon. But Dominic definitely wasn't the first thing Mario saw when he hatched. Dominic suspects that Mario was a domestic goose that had been abandoned at the lake, and so was looking for a new companion.
And he found me, and he determined I'm always safe to be with. When he's with me, he feels safe. He knows I'm one of him.
Jason believes that even though Mario didn't imprint on Dominic, those crucial few hours for the goose after it hatched were significant.
Imprinting has what's called a sensitive period. It's so many hours, 13 to 16 hours or so after birth, and then it gets locked in. So that sort of representation of what mom is supposed to look like doesn't change.
Okay.
So you imprint, and then that's your representation for the rest of your life. And
okay.
For the rest of your life, you know what mom looks like.
But Mario met Dominic when it was already an adult goose. So what does that suggest?
So it's possible, if this is a case of imprinting, it's possible that Mario imprinted onto someone who looked a lot like Dominic. When he was very young, mm-hmm. and Dominic may have certain facial characteristics or color of his hair or the shape of his facial hair, whatever, something that Mario recognizes as familiar.
Mario has found in Dominic a companion he can rely on. And like all geese, he's protective of what he's got.
His little nips are getting a little stronger every time, huh?
But it's, that's okay. When he attacks someone, it's not so much that he's trying to attack them to defend me, but really, he's trying to keep me. In other words, I'm his property.
Ow!
So if you would see his behavior, he was basically showing all the other geese, keep your distance, this is mine. Any goose that would get near, there'd be feathers flying. That's where he would show the most aggressiveness.
Ow, 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 ow. We're never going to find out exactly what happened in the early stages of Mario's life, but my money's on the fact that he probably did imprint on an elderly gentleman that looks suspiciously like Dominic over there. It just goes to show how strong an influence your early life experiences will have on how you behave as an adult.
So the early life of an animal plays a huge role in how it might bond with us. That first human it sees or lives with will impact on how it behaves in later life. But in the next stage of my journey, I'm going to meet three people who've managed to form lasting relationships with the most unpredictable animals by becoming part of the pack. Here at this privately owned wildlife park in South Africa, the staff are using a unique method to try and inspire the public to care more about animals. Poor Lazmi has managed to integrate herself with not one, but four lions. She's known these animals since they were cubs, and she's so confident they'll be well behaved that at this park, they'll even allow people into the enclosure with them. It's a controversial setup, even though there's always other members of her team keeping watch.
Hi.
But I'm intrigued to know how this relationship works and what she does to keep her lions in check.
Gotta say, I never thought I'd get this close to male lions in my life. Do I say hello or do I just stand here?
I can't see his eyes. No, you can say hello. He's being good.
Can I smell my hand? Or?
Yeah.
The fact that she needs to see their eyes points to just how unpredictable these animals can be.
Hi, Joseph. I like feeling your breath on my hand. That's nice.
You can touch him now as well.
Hi, Joseph. So three males.
And one female.
One female over there.
Yeah.
You know them very well, I take it.
Yeah.
From this behavior. What does he want to do with this paw there to kind of...
Yeah,
hold on
he's
to
looking
my arm.
To play now.
You want to play?
It's a bit too big for that.
Yeah, a little bit bigger than me, dude.
These lions are just 17 months old, but they are big enough to do some serious damage if they choose to.
Obviously, if I was in here without you...
That would be a totally different story. That's why it is important to us to remember they are wild animals, so their instincts can stay there. When they're younger, we take them on walks around the park and...
female.
That's Judith. We have a very strong bond with this group.
How is it possible that you can have such a close relationship with essentially wild animals?
We respect them as wild animals to start off with. I think that's one of the key points. Mm-hmm. We don't train them, we don't do anything like that. So you basically need to earn their trust and the respect. They've known me as a constant dominant figure in their life since they were babies, and that's why I'm able to go so up close to them now.
Okay, so you're mentioning a dominant figure, which means that hierarchy is at play here, understanding how these animals would normally behave in the wild.
Yeah.
So where are you in the pecking order, and how do you establish that with lions, albeit in captivity?
I think it's just because we've been there since they were babies, and I've always been the grown-up, so
what
I'm stronger in their eyes, I think.
Yeah.
And obviously they needed to have a figure that would put them back in place, and they are put back in place when they misbehave.
How do you learn how to do that? How did you...
Just from interacting with them. Over time, you learn their behavior. You learn to read their looks and mood swings and their different personalities.
And then as a human, you need to understand those in order not to get a swipe taken out of you.
Also... He got me.
Did he?
Not too long ago.
What happened?
It was a really hot day, and he picked up on me feeling weaker. And he grabbed me for a second, nothing serious, but I have a nice little scratch. And a few minutes later, I fainted. So he was obviously able to pick up on it before it happened.
So I should not be feeling a little bit weak right now or a little bit scared. I need to
kind of
let them know that I'm not feeling threatened by them, because instinctively
of
then they could react on that.
Yes.
Jeepers, I wish I'd been told that before, but hopefully I'm good to go. After you telling me that anecdote about you feeling weak, I'm now being a little, I'm feeling a little bit more,
he knows what he's allowed and not allowed to do. And he's definitely trying out. He's not lying down now because he's tired. He's lying down
I know
to try
this.
And get closer
I'm
to
I'm aware of this. I'm aware of this. Let's just breathe. What do you get out of this relationship? I've been so close with these lions.
I just feel privileged. Every single day you don't get used to it. Mm-hmm. Big ones or small ones, it's just an animal you need to appreciate.
Yeah.
And we definitely do.
Orr has clearly grown attached to these lions. But if things go according to plan, she won't have this relationship with them forever. The staff at the park are planning a very ambitious and untested project to do something that most people would consider impossible. They want to release these hand-reared lions into the wild when they're older.
I was under the impression that if any individuals are for release, you must have absolutely no contact with them.
That's what we're hoping to prove wrong, because you have, right now in South Africa, more lions in captivity than in the wild.
Yeah.
So if we can take the animals from this situation and prove that you can turn them wild again, then we can be saving quite a few of them. We believe it's possible, and we believe our intimate knowledge of these ones will help us achieve that goal. And hopefully they'll be our first ambassadors.
They're amazing animals, they really are. They're
perfect.
By behaving in a dominant manner, Orr has found a way to sit amongst lions. But as we're only just beginning to understand these unpredictable animals, I'd rather not repeat this experience anytime soon. The next person I'm meeting has had to find even more unusual methods to make sure his companion knows who's boss. This odd couple live in the heart of Texas, near the town of Quinlan. And they consist of a ton of buffalo named Wild Thing and his owner, a retired rodeo cowboy called R.C. Bridges. Ten years ago, R.C. lost his sight in one eye, forcing him to give up running his buffalo ranch. He sold his herd, but decided to keep one of the calves whose mother had struggled to suckle him. And it wasn't long before the young calf's behavior led to RC calling him Wild Thing.
Are you seriously doing this?
Luckily, RC knows how to calm Wild Thing down.
Do you ever get a little bit nervous going in with him?
Not at all.
No, you're totally used to it now.
I don't think he'd hurt me. If he does hurt me, it'd be an accident.
Really? Yeah, you're that sure of sort of your relationship
with him now?
How on earth is it possible for you to even be in here with this huge animal?
A lot of training. A lot of hours.
If I was to come in with you, what would happen?
He'd attack you.
Oh, good Lord. What do I do with my hands right now?
Just don't put them in here.
That's a good rule. He likes to be brushed.
Oh, he loves brushing, and the rougher you get, the better he likes it.
Now, RC, you know, it is a domesticated buffalo.
You'll never domesticate a buffalo.
Really?
No, they're a wild animal, and this one's probably a little more dangerous for you than a wild one because he would probably go out of his way to get you.
Why?
On my property. Now, if we're on somebody else's property, he probably won't bother you.
Buffalo live in large herds and will aggressively defend themselves and members of their group when threatened. But they also battle within the herd for status, with a strict hierarchy at play and only the top males getting a chance to mate. As RC found out, this jostling for position starts when they are very young.
So when he was a baby, every morning I'd get up and he would attack me. So I told my wife, I've tried all my cattle tricks, I've tried all my horse tricks, nothing working. I said, I'm gonna get up in the morning, I don't care how much he kicks me and how much he horns me, I'm gonna act like nothing's happening. I was bruised up from one end to the other, but by the end of the day, and it took me the whole day, by the end of the day, he was bored. Then he wanted to get everybody but me.
Okay, so it was almost sort of like eventually he just gave up on beating you around the place.
Yeah.
But also, you know, they do live in very strict linear hierarchies. So does that mean that he eventually saw you as the dominant male and that's why he gave up?
Oh, I'm the dominant male, yeah.
How do you establish dominance over buffalo and how do you maintain that?
By not having fear. You can't have any fear in you. You know, I don't have a choice about being the dominant one. If I'm not the dominant one, I'm in trouble.
So you've established dominance. So we know that in herds, linear hierarchies...
Don't do that. You understand me? Go ahead.
He scared the bejesus out of me just now.
Maintaining dominance over a calf was hard enough, but now that Wild Thing weighs over a ton, RC wouldn't survive a beating. So he's had to find new ways to remind Wild Thing who's the boss.
If Wild Thing's out here tearing up a gate or something and trying to get through, he can't get out most of the time. I can go over there and open it with one hand because I unlock it. And I open it, and he thinks I'm really strong because he might have been there an hour or two trying to get through that gate. But I go over there, and I just do it like it's nothing to it, and he really believes. He'll look at me, and he'll go, wow. I can grab him by the horns, and he thinks I got him. You know I don't have him, but he thinks I have him.
Oh, good Lord.
This is where I'm dominant right here. They don't like their horns messed with.
It is amazing that you can, you know, achieve that and even touch him the way you just did without him retaliating. I can't help thinking that every time he rams the gate, it's like, you are hogging too much of my time with RC. Back off.
He has a lot of love. I would have never thought this type of animal could feel love. Feels love.
He's a spectacular animal, there's no question.
And like if he's in the house and he needs to go to the bathroom, he'll go to the door.
If he's in the what?
If he's in the house.
He goes into your house?
Yeah, and if he's in the house and needs to go to the bathroom, then he won't use the bathroom in the house.
I need to see this. Go for it. Open the gate.
If you have to, shut the door, you know.
This is definitely the most stupid thing I've ever done, ever. He's definitely coming in the house. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Mind yourself. That is hilarious. He could still reach up to me and sniff me, you know. I'm a little bit scared. Wow. He's got really beautiful eyes. I can't get over how gentle he is with everything, RC.
Well, that's what amazes me about him, because I didn't teach him to be gentle. He just happens to be real gentle in the house and very aggressive and very mean on the outside of the house.
Does this all boil down to sort of territory? The paddock is his territory and he knows that you, this is your territory and you're the dominant male, so he needs to be respectful of that? Does that work?
I think that's what it is. I think when he's in the house, he knows this is my area and he needs to respect my area.
I heard something get knocked over, you see. So the minute he went outside again, he was trashing the place. Can I follow you, or is that too dangerous?
You can follow me as long as I can be between you.
Are you sure?
Mm-hmm.
You never taught him to be potty trained, for want of a better expression.
Never had it. I have no clue to how you would potty train a buffalo. But, so you got to realize, he knows that everything I do is for him. I never do anything that's against him. It's always for his protection or for his happiness. He's an exceptional buffalo. Then he's going to come in here and eat with me. Come on.
He's following him with the food. Oh, you gotta have a look at this. I never would have thought that I would see such a huge, powerful, unpredictable animal behave so gingerly in a home. All the ornaments around, he sniffs gently. He's literally tiptoeing around RC's home. It's just completely surreal to watch.
RC manages to maintain a bizarre appearance of domestic bliss with Wild Thing, spending time watching TV, mowing the lawn, and even going for a swim with him. And because Wild Thing thinks RC is the dominant male in his little herd, it certainly looks like he'll always tread softly around him. Strong leadership can enable you to maintain a close bond with some unpredictable animals. But I've come to South Africa to meet a man who's worked his way into an incredibly sophisticated animal hierarchy by doing it the animal's way. I want to find out what he's learned about animal behavior from his close interactions with some of the most intimidating animals yet. Hyenas. Renowned for their brutal, scavenging ways, hyenas can weigh twice as much as an adult wolf. So I'm quite relieved to have a cage between me and this clan of spotted hyenas.
There's a whole load of stuff going on right here. Jeepers.
Whoa.
Hi. Oh. You know what? It is easy to see how hyenas can be a little bit unnerving. I mean, they're built for power with their strange top-heavy postures. And when you think about their high-pitched screeches and laughs and the way they scavenge aggressively, they can seem quite sly and cunning. But actually, all of these traits point to a highly intelligent animal. Hi.
And that's why what Kevin Richardson does is all the more surprising. Kevin has worked with large predators for most of his adult life, but a few years ago, he set up his own private reserve so that he could fully integrate himself into this clan of hyenas. He did this to study their behavior and change people's perceptions of what is a much feared animal. The hyenas live in a large enclosure, but they're far from tame. These animals have a very complex and fluid social structure, all governed by dominance and how each one finds its place in the pecking order. If Kevin isn't careful, there's always an individual that'll try and get one over on him.
How on earth did this come about, this relationship you clearly have with these hyenas?
My career actually started with hyenas quite a long time ago. You know, they became my passion. And pretty much, yeah, I wanted to know everything about them. Okay, let's just let them get over with their whole thing.
Is this important for you to keep an eye on
Yeah,
this?
Very important. Because they're dominating this individual.
Okay.
They're trying to get him away.
And he's... his posture is submissive there,
Yeah,
it?
He's submissive.
Yeah.
Which is good.
So...
he's fine.
I didn't notice anything different. And immediately you're chatting away and you stopped. And you're like, okay, something has changed. Did you learn from your mistakes? Did you get...
I've learned the hard way.
Did you?
Yes. I've learned with hyenas, it's always the hard way.
Uh-huh.
They react, they bite you. and then they'll ask questions later. Let's put it into perspective for you. I've been working with large carnivores for 15 years. I've been hospitalized 5 times by hyena and none by lion. I got bitten very badly about 6 weeks ago. The one hyena thought it was a good opportunity to try and jostle for status in this clan. So he went for me in a very aggressive way, bit me on my arm and on my leg, and that triggered the rest of the clan to want to participate in the whole thing. There's probably a reason why a lot of people around the world don't work with these guys.
I wanted to ask you about, you know, where they see you in their clan. Are you a hyena in their eyes?
Their behavior with me is treating me as an individual in their clan is exactly how they treat one another. And that's why I get my fair share of bites, because they don't hold back.
So why on earth would you want to do this when you're aware that it can be dangerous?
What I feel is the risk has actually been mitigated over the years by knowing the individuals. And by no means do I just say, hey, I'm the hyena whisperer. I can go in with any hyena group and do what I do with these guys. This is a relationship that's been developing with some individuals over 14 years. Uh-huh. Where are you going? No, you're not going there.
Don't okay. Leave him, yes.
Sit down. Yes,
stay for the camera.
Yes, look at
see,
that.
See, now that's just ridiculous.
Look at that teddy bear.
I mean, come on. It's like if you're behaving with him, like if he's a dog, you know?
Well, listen, once all the energy dissipates, and mm-hmm. once they're okay with you guys, and they know they've smelt you out, and they see that you're not a threat,
yeah.
and they calm down, these animals are just, it's incredible what you can do with them. I mean, this guy
He desperately wants his chin scratched. Well, I mean, listen, I can see that. From me.
Kevin has worked very hard to earn the hyena's trust, and it allows him to play with them in a way I never thought was possible. But even this time spent playing together gives him a chance to learn about their social structure and how he can maintain his position within it.
Okay, so, I mean, all this kind of thing that I'm doing here is asserting my dominance. So it does look like play, but he's also feeling that I'm not, you know, submitting to something he does, and that I'm actually playing with him in a dominant way. So I'm doing things to him that he wouldn't normally allow other individuals to do to him that he was more dominant, who he was more dominant of. So it is interesting. I'm using affection because he's coming to me for love and a tickle and a chin scratch and all of the above. But I'm dominating him and I'm not hitting him, you know? I don't have to. It's a bit of a psychological game.
What do you get out of it then, do you think? Why were you driven to do this with these hyenas?
Well, I'll tell you what. I mean, this is enriching for me as it is for them. I mean, the fact that I'm tickling this hyena on his chin and I'm using him as a resting
place. It's bonkers, Kevin.
Yeah, it's awesome. I mean, don't get me wrong. I still get a kick out of seeing my buddies. However, the other thing that I really hope it does is it shows people a different side of them. Mm-hmm. And hopefully people watching a program like this would go away and say, you know what? I never knew hyenas were like that. I actually like them. They're actually very similar to my dog in a way.
It's fascinating watching you interacting with these kind of animals, you know, as you said, that do have such a sort of creepy reputation, fearsome reputation, and they are absolutely docile with you and so affectionate, and they don't seem to mind at all. It's quite surreal to watch, yeah. to watch that.
Come boy.
So
he's fine.
You just let me know when at any point something like this is just a little... I cannot believe I'm
no,
that close
fine.
To a hyena.
No, that's fine. It's completely fine.
I know you're a captive hyena, but this is ridiculous.
That's completely fine.
It's thrilling for me. I can't believe I'm so close to one. And they're so gentle.
No, hello. That's good.
Can I touch noses with you? Hello. Oh, come on.
Seeing the good side.
Oh, I really am.
Yeah.
I don't want to be lulled into a false sense of security, but you're just adorable right now.
Kevin has an extraordinary relationship with these hyenas. By combining his knowledge of each individual and their position in the hierarchy, and with his ability to assert his dominance where needed, it seems that Kevin has truly become one of the gang. And in doing so, he's proving that hyenas are not as intimidating as many people would have you believe.
There is definitely another side to these animals. They are incredibly gentle. I get a real feeling of affection from this particular one, who's liking the good back of the ear scratch right now. But they're also quite timid, they're quite shy. Some of them, when they approach the cage, you know, their eyes are really wide and they approach very cautiously. But every now and then they will bare their canines again. I guess that's another instinctual behavior to remind me, hey, I'm quite fearsome too, you know, I'm quite tough. But they are fantastic animals and you really get a sense of their individual personalities.
This is just thrilling. It really is.
The nature of the human-animal couples I've met so far is complex. But the people involved are attempting to fulfill a very human instinct to care for others, find companions, and better understand the world around us. But to find out what we can learn from looking at all these odd couples, I'm speaking to Professor Hal Herzog, who studied human-animal relationships for more than two decades.
What do you think we can learn about cross-species relationships in all their shapes and sizes?
I think what they tell us is the commonality that we have with other species, that at a deep level, animals have the same sorts of abilities to form relationships, to form attachments, to play, and they have the same abilities that we have. The bottom line for me is this. I think in our relationships with other species, what we see is a reflection of human nature in some ways, its purest form. And the best of human nature and the worst of human nature, and that to me is the thing that's really fascinating about this whole area of study.
There is one last partnership I want to investigate because for me, it truly reflects the best of what the human-animal bond can be like. Not only do both sides benefit, but here, wild animals have chosen to instigate a relationship with us. I've traveled all the way to the south of Brazil and the coastal town of Laguna to see it for myself. Here in this inlet on the Atlantic coast, the locals have formed a relationship over many generations with one specific group of wild dolphins. The dolphins help the fishermen catch their fish. In fact, the fishermen in this bay don't even throw their nets unless the dolphins are present.
It just looks so odd, a whole bunch of men standing in their waders, doing absolutely nothing, just standing there. There's a dolphin. There's two dolphins there, definitely surfacing, but they're just standing there, doing nothing still. This is extremely peculiar. What is going on? Makes me think that something's going to happen over here. Oh, whoosh. That's amazing. Okay, I'm beginning to get what's going on.
For 1 month of the year, schools of mullet migrate up the coast. The dolphins herd the schools into the shoreline, exactly where the fishermen are. Then, at the right moment, the dolphins make a signal, usually a distinctive dive, and the fishermen throw their nets to catch the fish beneath.
It's absolutely clear that the dolphins are calling the shots here. These lads are doing absolutely nothing. They just stand there with their nets, and it's only when the dolphin makes a very clear signal that they deploy them. So the dolphins are telling the fishermen how to fish. That's novel and completely crazy. I've never seen anything like this. This is the most intricate type of interaction between two completely different species I have ever seen. And it's just wonderful to watch because the fishermen are absolutely focused on getting their cue from a dolphin. And they have fun while they're at it, don't they? There's a fabulous energy on this beach. They really enjoy working with the dolphin. Go!
With the help of the dolphins, these fishermen are extremely successful. Just a few miles down the coast, the same mullet schools migrate. But because no dolphins help the fishermen there, they hardly catch any fish. Here, the dolphins have developed a relationship over generations that's resulted in a thriving local industry. I meet up with local scientist Fabio Dara Jorge from the University of Santa Catarina to find out exactly what's going on.
This is such a surreal scene.
Yeah.
There's a real energy to this, isn't there? There's a dolphin.
That's Caroba.
Caroba. Is he a well-known individual?
Yeah, yeah. It's the most famous dolphin we have here.
Fabio, watching this from the shore, it is absolutely mind-boggling.
Yeah, it's fascinating.
What is going on here?
Yeah, actually, the dolphins are bringing the mullets close to the fishermen. So
is that what he's doing right now?
Exactly. He's in the middle of the channel, and probably the mullet is here. Then when the dolphin make a specific signal, the fishermen know that's the right moment to throw the nets.
The fishermen are benefiting. Why on earth are the dolphins doing this?
We expect that when the fishermen threw the nets in the water, he's also pushing the mullets to the dolphins. Much easier for dolphins to get the mullets.
When the net's descending, some mullets are inevitably going to be escaping, and that's
exactly
the bounty that the dolphin can enjoy.
Exactly.
So it's a mutual symbiotic relationship going on, dictated by the dolphin, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they call the shots.
Exactly.
Yeah, come on, I want to go. I mean, how hard could it be, really? A bit slippy.
Putting your teeth.
In my mouth?
Yeah, exactly.
Dolphin!
Okay.
Oh, I'm scared.
Go.
Thank you. Autographs later. I can't believe that cheered at that. That was utter rubbish.
Great.
Did I catch a mullet?
Good job.
There is something so incredibly special going on here. I mean, we've known for a long time that dolphins are intelligent, and we have so many accounts of dolphin-human interactions of all sorts. But this dolphin-human interaction is very real, and it's very genuine, and it's incredibly complex on both sides. There's a whole series of intricate behavioral cues going on, and these are wild dolphins. They've chosen to come here and form a relationship with these fishermen. That's mind-blowing. I've been on a remarkable journey in these two programs, and I've encountered relationships between different species that have truly amazed me. Many of them have been formed as a result of powerful, natural instincts that seem to endure no matter what the circumstances. Or they've come about through a growing understanding some people have of the animal kingdom. And what's clear is that animals relate to one another and to us in a far more complex way than was previously thought possible.